الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله we are still in hadith number 19. This hadith, as we all know, that this is one of the comprehensive hadith, that as all the hadith in the 40 hadith is really, we should take it as a life changing hadith, because we have to always revisit it to make sure that we are upon it in the most perfect way. And this particular hadith, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, something that we need to memorize, where the Prophet والسلام, he said to him, as we heard before, Ya ghulam, O young boy, inni u'allimuka kalimatin, I will teach you words. So teaching you words, and he ordered him to memorize it, to memorize something that means to be upon it, and that's what the purpose of memorization. احفظ الله يحفظك. احفظ الله, as we said before, احفظ, that means the same word is used for memorizing. The same word is used for guarding. So guarding, when you make حفظ of something, that means you protect it, you guard it, you don't let it lost, to be lost. You take care of it, something that is precious. So احفظ الله, what does it mean to do this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That means, what is the relationship between the slave of Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is this nisbah? What is from us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ubudiyya, is to be abd, is to be a slave of Allah. That's always the nisbah between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if there is no ubudiyya, if there is no servitude, if there is no obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no value to this human being. He degraded himself to the worst level ever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran at the end of Surah Al-Furqan, قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ means يَكْتَرِثْ بِكُمْ, which literally it have that meaning of why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not care for you. He doesn't mean anything if it wasn't for your dua. And the dua is the ibadah and the dua itself. So احفظ الله, so guard the orders of Allah. Be always in that state. And the reward of it is from the same sort of deed that the person did. يحفظك, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guard you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you. And under يحفظك, all kinds of goodness that nobody can really imagine the way it's done, because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the promise of the truth. And the most important thing to be protected and guarded is the deen. So if someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guard him and protect him, and protect him in his deen, and they keep him steadfast on the deen, that's the most important thing, because that leads to the everlasting joy. The second statement, احفظ الله, again is repeated, تجده تجاهك. تجده, you would find him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, تجاهك. تجاهك, and also the وجه comes from it, that means in front of you, you know, facing you. And تجده تجاهك, and as we know, as the hadith and the ayat of the Quran, there is no contradiction. And the ways of the people of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is that they explain the ayat and the hadith in the light of the ayat and the hadith also, without falling into any contradictions. So, تَجِدْهُ تُجَاهَكْ, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above his throne, above his creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are the verses of the Quran that talks about this, and the ayat of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, تَجِدْهُ تُجَاهَكْ, Allah, so you would find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with you. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the sabirin, with the muttaqeen, and so on. That means he will be with you in all of your affairs, in all of your actions, to guide you, to keep you steadfast. And this is extra more than what is for everybody. For all of the creation of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them with his knowledge, with his power. So this is such a great virtue, all of which as a result of احفظ الله. احفظ الله, to guard the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also that has the meaning, as the Ramadan says, to be in that state of dhikr and remembrance of Allah. and not to be in a state of ghafla. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. And we have to pay attention to the way of the Prophet ﷺ saying it. He did not say, إِسْأَلِ اللَّهِ, ask Allah. He said, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ, whenever you ask, ask Allah. What does that signify? It signifies that in any time that a person asks for something, he should ask Allah. So it is not just ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather it says, whenever you ask, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether it's something that a person sits and make dua, or in the salah, or walking in the streets, or asking, if a person is about to ask anything from anyone, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from His bounty. Allahumma inni as'aluka min fadlik. You know, if whenever you ask, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that has all things, He's the owner of all things. And all of the makhluk, all the creation of Allah is under the power of Allah. They cannot benefit themselves or push away any harm. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ. And whenever you seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ. So every, you know, human beings, they always ask, regardless, they always seek help. We cannot do things on our own. So whenever you ask, whenever you seek help, فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And seeking help, الْإِعَانَة, is to do something, or to seek help from someone, because you cannot do it on your own. And as a human being, we cannot do anything on our own, because لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There's no might and there's no power but Allah, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As someone, you know, a person that is, you know, teaching people or whatever, when, you know, they sometimes, I read this statement, somebody, I've seen it today actually, someone is saying, you are strong, but you are stronger with Allah. This is not a good statement. And a person might think that we have to put confidence in the hearts of the people. You are strong, but you are stronger with Allah. But when you mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't say that you're strong. That's the thing here. Because you are the strongest ever if you seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's no point of mentioning your strength when a person is mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same context. Because everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how to rely on Allah. As if a person, if he's not with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's still strong. But he's stronger. You know, this is bad manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There is no might and there is no power except by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, if you ask, whenever you ask, ask Allah. Whenever you seek help from Allah. And this is what makes the person the strongest ever. When he is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he's seeking help from Allah, when he is taken, you know, being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the matter of belief. Why should you be upon this? Wa'alam, and have the knowledge with certainty. Anna al-ummata, that if the ummah, and the ummah here refers to the entire ummah, as we know that there are two ummas. There is ummat al-da'wah and ummat al-ijab. Ummat al-da'wah, the ummah that is the subject of the da'wah, that every messenger is sent to his ummah. And his ummah, meaning the disbelievers in his ummah and the entire people of his people. And the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ is the entire world, all mankind. And the ummah al-ijaba, the ummah that accepted the da'wah of the Prophet ﷺ, this is al-ijaba, the one that accepted the da'wah. So when we say the ummah, it can mean this or that. So that means, here wa'alam anna al-ummah, if the entire ummah, the entire humanity, لو اجتمعت, if they all get together, اجتمعت الأمة, from الاجتماع, to get together, على أن ينفعوك بشيء, so that they would ينفعوك, they benefit you, ينفعوك بشيء, with anything, بشيء, even if the smallest thing, شيء, can have under شيء, the smallest thing and the biggest thing, لم ينفعوك, they would not benefit you, except إلا بشيء, except by something, قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had wrote it for you. That's the belief in the qadr of Allah. So if they all they get together trying to benefit you with something, they won't benefit you except by something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had wrote it for you. And of course that implies that a person apply what's mentioned in the beginning. So the statement is to make it easier and how the matters of belief affects one's actions. If you want to guard the orders of Allah, if you want to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to be seeking help from Allah, this is because of what we believe, what's in the hearts, that if the entire humanity, they're trying to benefit you, they won't benefit you except by something that Allah wrote for you. وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ. And if they all get together, وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ, that they would harm you, بِشَيْءٍ, with anything, the smallest or the biggest, لَمْ يَضُرُّوكَ, they would not harm you, إِلَّا, except بِشَيْءٍ, by something, قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote it against you, which means harmful things. And everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means don't let your heart attach to other than Allah. And therefore you would be able to deal with people in the right way. If they don't benefit you with anything or they do not harm you with anything, you know, most of the time you would find yourself overlooking, you know, especially with the closest ones to oneself. To have the best manners is to overlook and not to be asking for every single right and from other human beings and so on. Everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He can change their hearts. And of course, by taking the means. And there is the level where the person finds himself, that the benefit and the harms, the ni'mah, the favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the baliyah, and the trials in this life, both, we are supposed to be pleased with the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed it. So, being pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, the human being, we like certain things. We like to be healthy, we like to be wealthy, we like to be, you know, having sufficiency and things like this. And a person is pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that state. And also, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree otherwise, from the materialistic things of this world, a person should be still have the rida. Not just patience. Patience is a must. But also to be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a reason. So this is also one of the great benefits. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامِ وَجَفَّتِ الصُّحُفِ. رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامِ, that means the pens have been lifted. وَجَفَّتِ الصُّحُفْ, and the صُحُفْ, the tablets or the sheets or so, جَفَّتْ, that means dried. And الْأَقْلَامُ الصُّحُفْ is where the decree is written. أَوَّلْ مَا خَلَقُ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ. The first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created is the pen. And He ordered to write everything till what's going to happen, you know, He ordered to write what everything will happen till the Day of Judgment. So everything is written in a suhuf. And a suhuf is with al-lawh al-mahfuz. No one knows the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even Jibreel alayhi salam, even the closest angels. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the qadr. It's the secret of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the narration of Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, qala hadithun hasanun sahih. Wa fi riwayati ghayri al-Tirmidhi, another narration other than the narration of al-Tirmidhi, احفظ الله تجده أمامك. Different slight changes of some words. احفظ الله. Protect the orders of Allah. Guard the orders of Allah, as we heard. تجده, you would find him أمامك, in front of you. أمامك, like to جهك. أمامك, in front of you. تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. تعرف إلى الله. تعرف means get yourself to know from المعرفة. And المعرفة comes in the same meaning of ilm or knowledge. But al-ma'rifah, if it's mentioned alone or specifically different from al-ilm, is by getting to know something that you didn't know before. So al-ma'rifah yasbiquha jahl. There's ignorance before ma'rifah. But ilm, not necessarily. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of His attributes is al-alim. So ta'arraf ila Allah, get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fil rakha, Al-Rakha is times of ease, times of benefits and ease and things like this. So to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة, he will know you, means that he will take care of you, he will guide you, he will support you. في الشدة, في الشدة means in times of tightness or difficulty. And الرخاء comes from when you ترخي للدابة الحبل مثلا. That means when the دابة, when you're riding a horse or something and you have a rein, and either you make it tight or you make it loose. So al-rakha is when at times of ease, not tight on the person. So when a person, he worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times of ease, grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat him in the same manner. He will know you, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows his creation, of course. But this is like ihfadillah, yahfadhk, the same way, the same way that a person is taking care of his duties and being obedient to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat him in the same way. And when it comes to the same way, nothing is the like of Allah. So that means it's far beyond what a person can imagine. So at times of necessity, at times of need, at times of difficulties, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you to support you, to help you, to keep you steadfast in the difficult times. You know, and the most difficult time, of course, as we all know, is the moment of death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give steadfastness to the believers at the moment of death because of their actions and their obedience to Allah. وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ مَا أَخْطَأَكْ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُصِيبَكَ. And know, have the knowledge that مَا أَخْطَأَكْ, what had missed you. Al-Khata is the mistake, right? So, and it comes also in the meaning of something did not afflicted the person, something missed the person. Like they use the same thing when you shooting an arrow. So you did not hit the target. You say أخطأت الهدف. So that means you missed the target. So if something has missed you, like as if an arrow is coming your way, but it didn't hit you, لم يكن ليصيبك. It was not meant لم يكن. It was, there was no way that it would have had يصيبك. That means that there's no way that it would have had hit you. الإصابة is to say what is right, is to hit something right, right? So when someone is again shooting an arrow, shooting something, a target, if he gets it right, he said asaba al-hadaf. Asaba al-hadaf, he hit the target. So anything that missed you coming your way, it was not meant for it to hit you or to have you, to afflict you. وَمَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُلْ يُخْطِئَكَ. وَمَا أَصَابَكَ, the opposite also is true. What hit you, what afflicted you, was never meant to miss you. So that means what? That means both ways in the life of the Muslim, he knows that it was never to be or meant to be otherwise. So when someone is afflicted with something good, it was not meant, he should not say, well, I was very close to this, and because of my effort, because of this, I have this. Or when a person is afflicted with something harmful, he would say, if I had missed this, I would have been better. There's no such a thing. If it's already done, that means it was never meant to miss you. We take the means, and the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unseen to us. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّصْرَ مَعَ الصَّبْرِ, and have the knowledge that النصر, victory, مَعَ الصَّبْرِ, with patience, not with the opposite. So if you want to be victorious, if you want to be helped, be patient. And patience with all what it means. To be patient with the orders of Allah, to be obedient to Allah, to be patient away from sins, to be patient on the qadr of Allah. And that's when it comes to an-nasr. The opposite of an-nasr is to be defeated. So when we see that the ummah is being defeated, for example, physically, right, we need to have the victory with as-sabr. So to be sabr, to have sabr, patience, to be obedient to Allah when at times of difficulties, to be away from sins and not to be tempted, not to compromise the deen because we're weak, and to please others, and to be patient with the qadr of Allah, that this is what Allah ordained upon the ummah, to be patient till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change the situation on the individual level or on the ummah level. وَأَنَّ الْفَرَجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ. Al-faraj is ease, the opening of of something that has been closed, مع الكرب, with the كرب, with the tightness of things, with the difficulties, with the miseries. And so this is an amazing, that means it comes after it. So the more things becomes difficult, the ease comes. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised in Surah Al-Mashrahak Sadrak and the like of this. So, and the same thing, the day and the light of the day comes after the darkest part of the night. So the same thing, that no difficulty and no tightness would stay forever. Everything changes. And this is how this life is. So the faraj and the ease comes with the tightness and the difficulties. So when a person is afflicted by something difficult or something that he dislikes, then he should have his heart attached by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the ease is coming. The ease is coming, so he need to be patient. He need to be pleased with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the ease comes. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised his creation to see that. وَأَنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. And with al-usr, with difficulty, with tightness, al-yusr comes, or ease. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated it twice. That means the two yusr with one usr. That means at all times, the yusr will come, the ease will come. And that's always the case with matters of belief, with being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is nothing more tight and more misery than the hellfire in the hereafter. There's nothing worse than a person when at the moment of death, he receives the news that he's among the people of the hellfire. There's nothing worse than this. So that means any tightness or difficulty in this life, if it leads the person to the Jannah, that's the real ease. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and he knows the weakness of ourselves. So the ease is even before that, within oneself. So a person should always rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make dhikr of Allah. Never rely with one's heart on other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And having these statements as knowledge, as certainty in one's heart, so that the person is able to live his life in a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from this hadith. And as we heard that we need to really have the knowledge of these words and to apply it in all of our lives and never to forget it and to keep on revisiting it. And that's the barakah and the blessings of being close to the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'll stop here inshallah ta'ala. I'll go now inshallah and we'll continue inshallah ta'ala next time. Jazakumullah khairan wa sallallahu alaihi wa sallam wa barakatuh Muhammad wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.